Criminal profiling is a process of analyzing a case by looking at the preliminary police reports, by looking at the profile of the victim, and you ask yourself the question, why was this victim the victim of this violent crime? I have to try to feel and experience what happened to the victim, and trying to put together a composite of the most probable type of an offender that is responsible for this crime. What you're trying to do is to cut down investigative man hours. Because when you conduct an investigation, you come up with thousands of potential suspects. It's always amazing to me. So what you want to do is to weed out. Yeah, these people are bad, but put them on the back burner. This is the kind of character that we're looking for right now. So let's focus in and refocus our investigation on this type of personality. I've been involved in over 5,000 different investigations. I've interviewed hundreds of offenders. So that's what you're relying on at the end, is you're going back into your mind, thinking of similar cases that you've done and the interviews that you've done and what you've learned from those interviews. And hopefully those common patterns, those common denominators, now you can use and apply to the case that
the thing that, that I strive to do during the interview is to try to bring them back. If it's a 20-year-old case, they've been in prison 20 years, is I try to turn on that little CD in their brain to get them back to the crime where now they're going to reenact it for me. And it happens.
You know, John, I'm kind of curious, not sure exactly how to phrase this, but the term would be like a successful serial killer, but somebody who actually gets away with it for a long time. Is somebody like that have to be of high intelligence to be able to pull it off?
Not really, because sometimes with that high intelligence, they think they're better, they're much smarter than law enforcement. I interviewed the BTK strangler, bind, torture, kill, a couple of years ago. I worked that case back in the 80s all the way up till he resurfaced again. And he was kind of smart in a way, but then he was pretty darn lucky. He stopped killing for years and years and years. So when I went to interview him, my main objective was, why did you stop killing? And one of the things with him was he was into cross-dressing, and he would take the clothing of his victims kind of as a memento, as a souvenir. So when he'd get back home and his wife was away at work, he put on this clothing. He had a plastic mask over his face he would paint that looks like a woman. But then one day, as he was doing this on his break, his wife came home and caught him. And she said, what's going on here? Well, wait a minute, I have a problem. You're darn right you have a problem. You know, just knock it off. So she contacted the friends of hers, worked at a VA center, but she never really put two and two together that she was married to the BTK strangler. So, and he didn't have a high IQ at all. He was just lucky. He worked for ADT security, and he was able to cut phone lines. He had a badge. He was able to gain access to people. So it was just luck, more luck than being smart.
I was in graduate school. I was living in a terrible environment, kind of like this terrible environment that we're in right now. And an FBI agent recruited me, and off I went. And I really didn't know much about it, but I was interested in behavioral science. And I was quite surprised that the research that they were doing was from a perspective of rehabilitation, from the perspective of corrections. People making these decisions in this country were actually making decisions having never looked at the crime itself. So what I decided to do was to go into the penitentiaries, generally at nighttime, very, very low lighting, unannounced, and go in there with my badge, and I could get into any penitentiary I wanted to with that FBI credential, and catch the bad guy by surprise, and just to see whether or not they'd be willing to talk to me. And I was quite surprised that never once did anyone say, no, I don't want to talk to you.
Charles Manson. I say that name, what does that make you think?
I interviewed Charles Manson two times, and I kind of knew how he acted, and I always do my research on the George Spahn Ranch where he lived with the women and Squeaky Fromm and Sandra Goodenet. And so the thing was interesting about him is he has 124 IQ with a fourth grade education. But I knew he was going to dominate me, physically dominate, but I'm tall, I'm 6'2 and everything. He's 5'4". So I didn't know what he was going to do, and he did it. He sat up on top of a chair. He sat up on top of the chair to dominate me, to look down at me, but I let him do it because I don't really care. I'm just trying to get information
out of
this character.
Then it's a question of power. power and control and domination. And again, it's this fantasy that, you know, that they have. And this fantasy is never really fulfilled. So when they commit a crime, it really doesn't go down as good as how the fantasy was. So they're never really fulfilled. And that's why they keep going and going and going. And unfortunately for law enforcement, sometimes we have to wait for them to,
of the serial killers,
when they finally start, it's usually around their mid-20s, and it's a precipitating stress or an event. And I've been into the penitentiaries throughout the United States and abroad, and it's always a mother thing with them. It's always, more so than the father, it's a mother thing where they may love their mother, but they hate her at the same time. And that is something that that will trigger that event. Or it could be something coupled with that. They lose a job. There's other conflict, personal conflicts in their life. So then they decide, aha, I'm going out. But it always begins with fueled by fantasy. Fantasy starts it, but the fantasy through pornography, through their own drawings, it may not satisfy. So they have to finally go out and do their thing and see if that will appease them, satisfy their urges.
I just don't believe that someone is born to be a serial killer. And one of the things that I found with the serial killers and serial rapists is that there's an early childhood experience, and they've had childhood traumas. And certainly with Hannibal, he experienced it, he witnessed it. It was his younger sister we saw that was cannibalized by these low-life deserters during World War II and killed his parents and took away his worldly possessions, but they weren't able to take away his intellect and his aristocratic training. There are some very good redeeming qualities about him. It's just he had this urge to kill. And he never would have been a cannibal had it not been from his early childhood experience.
Those interested in this kind of work here, you just can't judge a book by its cover. There's not a look of a particular look of a rapist or a murderer. Some could be very, 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 very charming, and you can be fooled. And then there'll be police in the audience, and I'll give some information to them about understanding crime scenes. And the students too will see this, how you assess the situations.